So I just like to say a little bit about my background. I do. I was huge, also a great finance in my life. Now, what do I do with the kids? So, Canberra, 100 people, something like that, founded in 2005, it's our 13th lucky year. So, that's great. Now, for activity is my bit, yes, so off my off parameters, and just a wonderful team there with 20 people. And this is our 5th year, so. But why are we here? What do we follow? We want to make a free software rock. That's our mission. Here to do open source stuff and to, if we're doing that, we're happy. So when you invest all your money and it comes into us, straight back into the big office and open source software, by hiring developers, building partners' business, in marketing, telling people about it. I just said a little line about Clarus, that is the parent company, and it does cool stuff. We push open source everywhere we go. So we're getting Linux, kernels into everything. Devices everywhere, from mobile phones to cars to artificial intelligence systems to augmented reality devices, all sorts of stuff, medical, imaging, multimedia stuff, from Chromebooks through to just crazy goggles and web, everywhere. We're driving Linux and free software, pushing it up the stack, richer and richer. So we work with all sorts of people, but our productivity is perhaps more interesting. And we do, just I can give you some samples of some of our customers. So we work with AMD, for example. Of course, Cloud also works with Intel, also with ARM. But AMD is particularly cool because they have chips that have all these lovely threads in them. They've driven down the price of that thread just amazingly. I'll talk about that in a minute. And we work with them with the pre-release hardware that they have to make sure that LibreOffice runs excessively well on it. We also support products. So out in the market, people use LibreOffice on PCs. They use a supported version of Collabora Office. And so one of the top three Italian banks has 20,000 seats in the bank. This is why I have time, just so I like you might buy something from you if you're in a bank. We also partner with a lot of people, 130 partners or so, and it's growing. But this is just an example of the Dutch electric data classification. But there's lots of people who have privacy needs that want to keep their documents secret. And that's, of course, increasingly popular in the modern world. And then, of course, we partner with OEMs like Dell and take our software and rebundle it into their products and ship them. So, cool stuff. And we love to do that with partners. See, Clara is really a partner-driven company. We prefer to help you succeed in your market. And to stand behind you so you are credible. Even if you're only one person, you can stand up and you have the weight of the collateral behind you to help you. And that really helps the support. So one of the problems I see out there is that you end up in this blame game situation. Whose fault is it? I think it's banks. And the clever man at the bank has outsourced all of the people in his team to someone else. So the sysadmin that did hardware went to HCL and the guy that actually does the typing, well, he went to Accenture, and someone else went, and so you look around the room, and everybody is pointing at each other and trying to kill each other just for sitting in the room. And it's amazing, because I go to that environment and go, yeah, this is actually our bug. It really is. It's a problem in our software, We will fix it for you as quickly as we can. And you go, what? That's not how this is supposed to work. And they start arguing, no, maybe it's our problem. It's just amazing to sort of see that. Blame game inverted, it could be us. So it's exactly not like this with us. We sell for our partners, so as a customer you can buy from a partner, and you have a single support channel, you talk to that partner, you buy from that partner, you have one set of approved paperwork to get them there, and there's a single point of responsibility there, and it's not your problem. If you have bought the product, you have someone who will support you, and it's all their fault. Yeah, they will come and make it our fault. When that's necessary. And of course, they speak your language. We have 55 countries served by 130 partners. And they do this cool stuff, selling this online. So, and I think the other thing is we encourage you, as you get out there and say, please partner with us. We can help you do this well. We can support you. We can make you, give you a product offering you can sell. We encourage people to invest in office and getting that out into the world alongside us. So it's sort of multiplying. most love to go over was a community members who actually really know what they're doing and are, you know, have been contributing to the project. So we have all the partners who we do this with. This is obviously a kind of online partner. These partners, we have other kinds of partners as well. And I think this is why I'm particularly like sort of highlighting that support thing. You know, here's the team leader support, Carlos, and he says, I mean, the main thing is I sit down with these people and they say these things, and I forget to write them down. But in this case, I just, you know, what he said, just the conference last week, perfect communication. I mean, you can't ask people to say this sort of stuff, it just comes out immediate proactive support, so that's kind of cool. Easy to deploy, join the hub, come in, standing behind you. And of course, other partners are left alongside us. We're really thrilled to have Aurora, Philippe, let's say that, doing cool stuff, just driving Aurora out into Alfresco, and that SharePoint-like ecosystem. We see lots of people who have SharePoint-like things out there. They don't know what they want, it should be like SharePoint. Right? And so we can do that now with Aurora's great work, making this go on, of course, Magenta. Some work there to get this embedded into Alfresco and working nicely. So we do several kinds of things. We sell products, but we also do consulting. I'll just give you a few examples. That is EPUB support. So a customer of known contribution names wanted EPUB support, and they're eager to get it done. And they wanted to contribute it, built it, used to be included, sort of the new PDF of the world, supposedly. And so they got me Tosh just eaters away doing this. I mentioned AMD before, they have hardware with loads of threads, great, powerful, wonderful bits of hardware. Isn't it great to actually use that hardware in CAP? So instead of sitting there for a minute, you sit there for a minute divided by, well, 10, perhaps, if it's been threads, right? So that can be really helpful. There's some numbers here, but really I think the key thing here is just getting affordable threads, something we have in today's world. And perhaps you should renew your build system. Build incredibly well. And so, did you get one? And we'll have a talk on improving the parallel calculation. Actually, just later, we've done a huge amount of work to, over the last year, to not so much create radical new graphs, but make it really reliable and robust, and improve the implementation a lot. So, another thing, so another example of consulting I like is finally getting this MySQL connector issue solved. So, we have another anonymous customer. Some customers don't like us. Tell who they are. I don't know why this is, but they are. And this has, we've had real problems with this connector being an external component. And we've finally been getting this actually built in and working and bundling with products and running DBs libraries. And other happy customers. Southeast Healthcare, we turn off fancy seats there. I'm greeting to Cabra office. You were perhaps seen before, quantum computing, the big office. So this is some percent consultancy bits. Talk about products. So people think that they ought to use LibreOffice for free in the enterprise, you know, the authentic LibreOffice. But the problem is rapidly they want a new feature, they want a new fix, and then you have something that isn't really LibreOffice, it's something kind of custom and so on. And we can provide that for you. When we brand it and better than that, we give you all the fixes that everybody else wanted as well. So you get a nice roll-up bundle, and we call this GlabOffice. And we make that easy to deploy on Windows, so it has patches, easy to map in group policy lockdown, and you can file as many bugs as you like. It's great. And of course, you can talk to myself and the team and get your product features from me. It's reasonably cheap. 1,000 seats, something like under €1 per user per month. So you're approaching the 10th of what Microsoft charge. If you really want your bug fixed, really now, you've got to have it done. Then you can buy an SLA on bug fixing, so an engineer starts work on a bug in 1 to 2 days. Of course, we can't promise you can fix it in 10 minutes. Sometimes bugs take, actually on average, about a week to fix. But, yeah, well, we will fix it for you fast and get you an ETL built, and you can QA, make sure it works nicely for you, and that's all cool. And so we then provide fixed prices for that. So you can be confident, you can budget against that. You can estimate how many problems you have, and we'll fix any bug for you. Any root cause but for a flat cost. That of course only applies when you haven't filed it upstream first to see if it was easy and hope someone fixed it for you and then ask someone else and then ask them. Because averages don't work like that. So I mentioned some of these people, I think, before. Let me move on from there. Nice and terrible example. We can't write good tests. We didn't want to fix bugs for people and then see them come back again. That's a bad customer experience if I pay for a bug fix. It comes back again in the next release. So we write up a lot of unit tests and do lots of auto testing there to try and make this significantly better. Another thing we see in migrations is that people often have horrible macro-driven things. So it's a parking ticket system in a local government, you know? And it's been written in Visual Basic with some horrible Microsoft Office integration in the background. And anyone sensible wouldn't have written it as a VBA macro or VB macro or an external VB6 program that's compiled to an executable. So sensible people don't do that. Sensible people also then hire another external consultant to do that. 20 years ago, we only have binary, no source code. So we can help unlock these problems so you can actually migrate these. So we create something called the Collaborative Automation Tool, and Saul has a talk, I think, on all the gory details, some later today, if not, again, I'm going to talk to him. But essentially, redirects those things to VBOffice. So you can run an unmodified VB6 application and for the API support, which is quite a good set, it will just work. And if it doesn't, we can fix it for you. So, all these tools to get Collaborate onto PCs, more and more PCs, and for people. But we're also building Collaborate online. This is really the tip of the spear of what we're doing. I guess this is how it works. So people say, oh, is it like Google Docs? Of course it's not, it's better. So, it looks pretty, you see all these presence indications, you can see all these selections and cursors, collaborative, getting all of them. And yeah, it's built on LibreOffice, of course, it brings LibreOffice into the browser. And yeah, lots of good things going on there. All of the interoperability of LibreOffice core, lots of nice filters for document preparation for various things, and of course the on-premise listing that goes to our archives. The big bet here is that our CPU and threading gets faster. Threads get faster, AMD is doing a great job of that. Networking gets cheaper. 7G is just around the corner. So it seems a reasonable bet. But why online? Well, these are all the obvious things. Controlling your data, controlling who else is using your hardware. If you've been reading the news recently, you'll discover that all those cloud services, even if they're hosted in Albania, which is a good thing for compliance, someone from some bad hacked country, I don't know which country is supposed to be bad today, let's say it's America, okay? They can log into your machine, and you know, because of the processor that you put into that, might not be quite as good as what they mean from an isolation perspective. Then they can start reading your data from afar. So actually being able to control who is on your hardware, having it in-house and owning it, can actually be a serious benefit. Other things that are nice here is that ODF is of course really important for opening document formats. And it would be nice to provide everybody with a pre-installed LibreOffice Drive product everywhere. But wouldn't it be nice if you just send a web link instead? So being able to do that through the browser, with zero touch of advice, significantly reduces the impact of document formats. So you can send them a ODF document and everyone can read it, edit it, and comment it, which is really nice. So we're investing pretty heavily here. I think last year I spent about €500,000 down on the investment. I think now we're only €400,000 down, and we invested a whole lot more than last year. So that's good. So we're slowly getting up there. It's something like 95% of the commits to that. And of course, I've shown you some of these things. Compared to our competition, which is, I guess, Word, Office Online, there's a whole lot of things we can do. We're a proper wizard computer, so and you get columns, and you can do change tracking in it. I think just a little quiz on change tracking earlier, everyone was done it, okay? But it turns out that Word Online can't do change tracking. But we can. So, yeah, there are areas we can win here, which is just always encouraging from a feature function perspective. Small features like change tracking. So it looks pretty good. We can also insert charts into Word documents, which again you can't do in Word with Word Online. Which is, who wants to do that anyway? And it's kind of written, but we're improving it. The best way to get that, I think, really is through code, which is a development edition. It's completely sensible for home use to use that. It's not terribly developer-y.
We have about 7.5 million British, 8 million Docker image pulls of that, which is encouraging. It's nice to see people actually out there using that. And we can't tell how many customers, how many users which is Docker image pulls, but who knows. But by itself, it's pretty useless. If you can do a Docker image pull and run it, you see nothing. Because you need an integration with something else, like NCAP, Nextcloud, IBM, CFile, Grigware, lots of these things out there. And I think you need SSL certificates at work, which is quite challenging. Just to let you in the picture, in case any geeks in the background want to have pictures. Now, this is a 40,000 seat deployment of CloudOne. And you can see the sort of daily works, like some of the daily workers, some of three workers, 4 cores each. I have some RAM problems, actually, I've been using very little RAM too. But nice to see, you know, they're serving 2,000 people pretty much every day, 5,000 to 6,000, some days, actually, yeah. If you have a case study, I can tell you who they are, at least certainly I guess. So what are we doing? Well, Kenji's had a press talk later this afternoon, we'll go through in more detail. I just want to give you some quick pictures of things we've been doing. So this is all based on customer part feedback, so data validation and data filtering are really important. Velocity or spreadsheets, they need to check boxes in. They need to select items from lists. So we are going to move into that. The product needed to be much richer so you could use dialogues from the browser. So bringing the existing LibreOffice dialogues through to the browser and sharing to the keys, look at that, charting in lots of places. Our Asian friends and the IME support for various complex languages. Here's the IPv6, those who are still with us. Better graphing and so on. One of these last things is outbound monitoring connection is critical for the Alfresco integration. So we'll be blocking show up from there. New things coming in 6.2, so improved latency. We've been working very hard on this to make it less annoying as a type. So instead of moving the cursor and then sharing the updated text, doing both of these things at the same time, twice as fast, pretty helps. So some things there. And improving the mobile user experience is a big thing we're working on. So yes, various separate features there. And some pretty pictures, nice shape editing, which we've been wanting. Much improved mobile stuff. Sidebar bits going on, so starting to tunnel sidebars and remembering across to the mobile version to add functionality to the rest. Yeah, I just wanted to talk a bit about branding here. So we used a brand for this for LibreOffice from Collabra for 2 years when we first started. The LibreOffice brand was not incredibly well known on day one of the project. But after a while it became pretty clear that there was some scope for confusion here between LibreOffice, Collabra and other things. And so the brands are an asset as well. You know, I'm often told, or I'm occasionally told, but you know, one of TDF's most important assets is not a million euros of cash sitting in its bank accounts or the tens of millions of users of with goodwill as a project, but the brand. And so there's probably some strength in that, truth there. But it's clear that Collabra also has very few assets. We're an open source company. Everything we do is contributed out there. And so it seems sensible to build our brand as well. Here goes our screen. So our product is a branch in public Git. You get help out, you can see the Git commits and build it yourself pretty easily. But we want to use our brand to frame something different from what LibreOffice needs. It's an enterprise product, but it's supported, but it has long-term support. There isn't a free download advertised on our front page. There is a scarcity there. It means you might want to pay. And if you like what we do, if you think something is cool, worth supporting, please help us. Some people have our brand. There's t-shirts in the package. Consider wearing one. As you see, I'm not wearing one. So, wear one, one day. Maybe not every day. Wear a red hat t-shirt. Encourage these guys to. It's really important that people who contribute to our ecosystem get mentioned and credit, and we support those people. And we talk about their brands, which will be a key part of how we're going to work. And I have a lot more to say on this topic. On how TDF markets, LibreOffice, and how it works with its ecosystem companies. As you can see, our logo is based on something like this is the beak. I have called the beak and the Collabra, existing Collabra logo, which we can't see, or which we've turned into a sort of document thing. So, being a partner tool, we get access to all our again, like this apartment portal, it looks pretty. You get all of our binaries and punch through the scarcity that your customers want to pay for. And also support a ticketing system. So you can give that to your customers. Our customers quite well. Here's some others. 30,000 users in the University of Berlin, Technical University, they have something like that. And yeah, and they deploy that online, no problems. It's a bit awful. As a product manager, it's distressing for me. I want to hear about problems so I can fix them. But yeah, easy to provide, it just works. Again, there's not part of our from our problem. Thinking about responsiveness. You know, actually, in contrast to a huge major, here's a company you can deal with who gives you a really good response. You know, enjoys becoming a reasonably sized company that cares about your business. So we're sponsoring the meal. I think some community meal sausage. I thought, okay, so they got 5 years to help us celebrate. But in those 5 years, we've done quite a lot. So this, I think, is the last year, earlier. So every year I sit there, so I hope for this to continue to improve diversity-wise, by which I mean more companies and more individuals getting involved, and I will do more, but in a small proportion. I was not very successful in my aspiration this year, but it is gratifying to be able to contribute a lot alongside people. It's also important to point out that ETF has a relatively small chunk here that's doing a lot of really useful work. And some proportion of our clients, for example, were funded by TDF from our donors. So that was about 7% of our revenue this year and 0% last year. So it's maybe 3.5-4% of our clients could perhaps be attributed to the TDF donors. And so we have about 19 collaborators completed in the last year, the last 12 months, a couple of interns. I'm incredibly thrilled to have a team packed full of wonderful engineers, and it's just an amazing privilege to try and serve them. So yes, we've done something about nearly 30,000 commits in 5 years, 34% of all in the last year. Commits is not a perfect measurement, it's a measure of contribution, but it's at least a measurement. Something like 16 a day, 7 days a week, 4 or 5 years sustained. And of course, there are lots of other things we need to I'd like to get involved with the community, insert, lots of ways, attribute, mentoring, you know. So, in conclusion, this is the last slide. If you can see the numbers at the bottom itself. Yeah, so our mission is to make it resource rock. In this context, it's to make LibreOffice succeed, to make it ever better, and to grow the community, and to grow the product, make it more feasible, and so on. And we don't have a magic money tree, unfortunately. So everything we do is paid for by customer or partner. So once again, these sponsored conference, we're thrilled to do that. That was all paid for, of course, by our hard work, but also by our customers actually paying us. So thank you to all of those people who have done that. It's much appreciated. Thank you to all the people who partnered with us, particularly those who provided quotes like I put on my slide. They're much extra appreciated. And if you're one of those people, you're changing the world for the better. It's all about the staff, we're cool. And we couldn't do it without the community. So thank you again for those, just the amazing contribution for so many in so many ways. And not just coding, not just translating, cover all this, but UX design and all these things. But just supporting us, telling people about what we're doing, lobbying, marketing, encouraging people to use free software alternative. That's cool. Our brand is one of our own assets, please help us build it. And particularly when we talk about online, when we do 95% of the revenue. It's really a pleasure to be here, to sponsor the community, to learn how to be. Well, I'm working on that. And the last thing to say is we're hiring. So if you want to join the team, get involved, maybe some marketing, maybe do development, if you're a JavaScript programmer, I'm working on these other guys, do see me afterwards. I'd love to talk to you. Thank you very much.